Periscopers, Dr. Olivia Joseph here. I'm going to talk to you about, I don't want to say one of my most favorite topics, but I'm going to talk to you about a topic that I see an awful lot of patients for. And to be totally honest with you, it totally breaks my heart because I've been in practice for 13 years now. And over the last 13 years, the amount of patients that I see that have autoimmune disease is growing and growing and growing. And statistically, it's going up across the United States and across the world. So let me teach you some basic but extremely effective things you can look at if you have an autoimmune disease. But before we talk about that, I am grouping all autoimmune diseases together. Whether it's celiac, whether it's Hashimoto's thyroiditis, whether it's vitiligo, ulcerative colitis, I look at all autoimmune diseases the exact same way in the beginning stages. And then as we get more advanced with the clinical nutrition and the functional testing that we do, then I'm tailoring the protocol more specific to that person's needs. I might run some testing on someone with one autoimmune disease and different type of testing on someone with another. Doesn't really matter. I just want to talk to you about the foundational things that you need to be looking at regardless of what autoimmune disease you have. So the first thing is what causes autoimmune disease? Our genes. At least that's the answer that you keep getting, that autoimmune disease is genetic. So let me tell you something about your genes. They might load the gun, but it's your lifestyle that pulls the trigger. Okay, so things that you do can allow that gene to express itself. All right, why is it that someone with celiac, which is an autoimmune disease to wheat or gluten, or someone with Hashimoto's can have totally normal thyroid tests, and then boom, one day they have an autoimmune disease in their thyroid. Somebody can eat wheat or gluten their entire life, and then boom, one day, all of a sudden, they're in the hospital after eating wheat. Somebody with ulcerative colitis can eat anything they want, and then one day, boom, they land in the hospital and they have ulcerations in their colon. These things do not develop overnight. They're a ticking time bomb that needs to be disrupted or disturbed in order for it to come alive. So one thing diet-wise that totally feeds a fire is gluten. And I know you don't want to hear that. Gluten doesn't have much benefit. And one, gluten gets a lot of bad attention, rightfully so, in the United States. And let me explain why gluten is the bad guy. Gluten is inflammatory. It is the most inflammatory grain that there is. So if you have an autoimmune disease or if you have a chronic inflammatory condition, get gluten out of your diet. It's one of the best things you can do. Now, I've heard a lot of even nutrition experts out there say that gluten's the bad guy because it's genetically modified. If you do any research on gluten, you're going to find out it is not genetically modified. Now, there are a lot of things that are, believe me, corn, soy, cotton, the list goes on and on. But gluten is not genetically modified. But what happens is gluten grows, or wheat grows. Gluten doesn't grow. Gluten is the protein found in wheat, and so is gliadin. Wheat grows a lot like grass. And if you've ever put grass seeds down, one thing you'll notice is that they do not grow evenly. You'll have patches of healthy grass here, but then over here, nothing's growing. That's how wheat grows. So what we do in our farming methods with non-organic wheat is we put Roundup on the soil, we soak the soil with Roundup, which is glycophosphate, which is a chemical that is known to cause cancer. There's no question about it. Science and research point to that. So then when you put the grass seeds out, they soak up this Roundup chemical, and then the grass grows evenly. So farmers like that versus, oh, I've got a healthy wheat patch here, but here I've got nothing going on. So wheat is very, very inflammatory, not just because it's the nature of the grain, but it's because that grain has absorbed a lot of these chemicals which disrupt your immune system, which is what triggers an autoimmune disease. So when you eat gluten and you have an autoimmune disease, what happens is you're telling the gluten where to attack. It's not that gluten's the bad guy. He causes inflammation all over. But when you have an autoimmune disease, you're telling gluten where to attack. When you have colitis, you're telling the gluten, go after the colon. When you have vitiligo, you're telling the gluten, go after the skin. When you have Hashimoto's, go after the thyroid. So you're telling gluten what to attack when you have an autoimmune disease. So you can heal your gut. You can go into remission. That's not a problem, but if you eat gluten again or start eating gluten a little bit here, a little bit there, it's kind of like fueling the fire. It's a ticking time bomb. You're waiting for something bad to happen. So a gluten-free diet is something that I put all of my patients with autoimmune disease on. Second thing I do, and this is clinically the most important, and if you do not have access to a practitioner who does clinical nutrition, functional medicine, integrative medicine, I'm gonna tell you a way you can get your hands on this testing and this information on your own, okay? I look at the integrity of my patient's gut. Now, gut is kind of a trendy word right now. It's not trendy. Functional medicine practitioners have been talking about leaky gut since the 70s, but it wasn't a real medical diagnosis. Now it's a real medical diagnosis. We've known about it for 40 plus years. This is nothing new. This is nothing trendy. This is a very real problem that's been around for a long time and is getting worse and worse. So how do we test for gut integrity? First thing I do is a food sensitivity test. Now I look for delayed antibodies to foods. That's IgG immunoglobulins. I test 95 foods at once, and we send that blood to a lab that is going to monitor that blood sample for not just 3 hours, 12 hours, for up to 72 hours. Because when you're dealing with food sensitivities, it's not like you eat peanuts and your mouth swells or you get hives. That's an immediate immune response. That's an anaphylactic response is what that is. What happens when you have food sensitivities is it's a delayed response. You might not see the response for 24, 48, 72 hours, and there's a good chance you will have eaten that food again in that time frame. And then that inflammation accumulates until it's the straw that breaks the camel's back. The other thing with food sensitivities is you have to identify all of them and remove all of those foods at the same time in order to heal the gut. Okay, so I test for food sensitivities, leaky gut. You can test for leaky gut. There are things that belong inside the gut, not in the bloodstream. When we run these tests, it's blood testing. So if we find certain proteins and certain bad bugs in the bloodstream, we know we're dealing with leaky gut because they are not supposed to be there ever. And if they're present in the bloodstream, you're dealing with leaky gut. And the testing I do also looks for something called dysbiosis. All that means is there's an overgrowth of bad bugs. And there's different bad bugs. There's parasites. I'll be totally honest with you. Out of parasites, bacteria, small intestinal bacterial overgrowth, and yeast, Candida albicans, parasites are the thing I see in my practice the least. I'm not saying parasites are not an issue. They absolutely positively are. It's just what I see in practice, I would say the least. We see a lot of SIBO or small intestinal bacterial overgrowth. How do you find that out? I work with a gastroenterologist. I refer out to him and he runs a breath test, which is looking for methane gas, which is only present if you have an overgrowth of small intestinal bacterial overgrowth. But what I see the most in practice is probably yeast. Now, we all have yeast in our guts. It does not belong in the bloodstream. So the lab that I use tests for yeast antigen in the bloodstream, and it should not be there. And the problem is your immune system lives in your gut. So if you have an autoimmune disease, you might have some of these issues that I'm talking about. Whether you're genetically programmed or not, your genes load the gun, your lifestyle pulls the trigger. The other thing I want to say in talking to you about genes is test the genes. It infuriates me. I'm a passionate nutritionist. It infuriates me when we blame things on genes, but yet we don't do genetic testing. So doing genomic testing at the very least, MTHFR, gene mutation testing. Now, that's only looking at three genes responsible for detoxification and absorption of nutrients. So if we're going to blame something on genes, let's do more genetic testing. I use in practice with my patients a lab called Genova Diagnostics. If you go to genova.com, there's so much information on genomic testing out there. They're a phenomenal lab. If you're trying to get access to some genetic testing on your own, without your physician ordering it, go to 23andme.com. Now, as docs, we don't love 23andMe as much because their reports are very hard to read. Not just for you, for us as doctors. So we love Genova because they give us fancy reports, which are easier for us to interpret and easier for us to explain to our patients. But that's how you can get genetic testing. If your practitioner does not do food sensitivity testing, which are delayed antigens to food, IgG, that's only done by specialty labs, by a specialty lab. So if your physician doesn't do this testing or have an account with a lab that does this testing, then I will tell you the lab that I use has an option where you can order the test yourself. You go to meridianvalleylab.com and you can order a test kit for the most common foods. You can call them and they'll tell you a place to go get your blood draw. The only problem is you might not know what to do with this testing, but it will identify the foods that you need to remove from your diet in order to heal your gut. And it'll also show if you've got this yeast overgrowth or a yeast antigen in your bloodstream. So these are some ways to look at the real root cause, not of what caused the autoimmune disease, but what triggered it to manifest. So it's very important that you take this seriously because people with autoimmune disease have higher levels of inflammation. Higher levels of inflammation increase your risk for a heart attack and a stroke. Higher levels of inflammation or having an autoimmune disease predisposes you to cancer. And last but not least, your brain hormones that your brain uses are made in your gut. So your gut and brain are connected. It's called the gut-brain axis. So if you don't have a healthy gut, there's no way you're gonna have a healthy immune system. There's no way you're gonna have a healthy brain. You're not gonna have a healthy hormone system, a healthy detoxification system. You're gonna have chronic fatigue, pain, brain fog. So look to the gut. Look to see how healthy the gut is. Identify what foods you need to remove based on your needs, based on your genetic predisposition to food sensitivities. Gluten-free for everybody who has anything autoimmune. I'm telling you right now, that's the first thing I do with my patients while I'm waiting for their test results to come in. And then I am typically putting them on some nutritional support to not only reduce inflammation, but also to heal the gut. So it's no secret. What I use in my practice is ginger, turmeric, in order to reduce inflammation. And I also use L-glutamine to help heal the gut. But if you don't identify what food sensitivities you have and remove all of those foods while you're trying to heal the gut, your results are going to be very, very limited. So I hope you enjoyed this information. We've got a lot more scopes coming your way on healing the gut, food sensitivities, allergies in general, especially as we go into allergy season. So thank you for listening and watching.